Corporation, brought to you by Ray Orin and supported by LSC. We would like to thank our registration partner, MapMyIndia, CX Partner Gendex, Session Partner ShipLight, Silver Partner Fretron, Knowledge Partner Supply Chain Labs, and Industry Partner PhD Chamber of Commerce and Industry. My name is Sri Raj Deshmukh, and I will be your host for this session. We are now moving on to the next session on evolution of technology landscape in logistics and supply chain in India. I would like to introduce you to the moderator of this session, Mr. Prashant Garg, who is a partner at Ernst & Young LLP. And next, I would like to welcome the panelists, Mr. Aditya Wagre, Head of Strategic Partnerships and Alliances at Here India, Mr. Aniruddha Karnataki, Vice President, Supply Chain Management at CA Tires, Mr. Ashish Khare, General Manager and Global Head, IoT and Smart City at Wipro, Mr. Kushnath Khan, Co-Founder and CEO of Arzu, and last but not the least, Mr. Srikant Panjeshwaran, Director and Head of Supply Chain at Godrej Consumer Products. I would request Mr. Prashant to take over from here. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Amiyai, and thank you for all our esteemed colleagues joining in for this discussion. I think it's a very interesting discussion considering technology is playing a significant part in the way we are able to manage the supply chain now. From having solutions like retail apps like Amazon, etc., changing our lives, and having technology which is changing the last mile delivery, there is a lot that goes in from a technology perspective in right planning, right optimization, ensuring that we are producing the right things at the right place so that the shipment time is lost, is least, the cost is least, and we are able to provide the most optimized solution in terms of supply chain management to our customers and clients, at least in EY. I wish to start this discussion by very quickly having an introduction of our esteemed panel members. We've got Mr. Aniruddha Karnataki, who is a VP Supply Chain at CA Tires. We've got Srikant Vancheshwaran, Director and Head of Supply Chain at Godrej Consumer Products. We have Mr. Kushmuth Khan, Co-Founder and CEO of Arzu. We have Aditya Wagre, who is Head of Strategic Partnerships and Alliances at Here India. And we have Mr. Ashish Khare, who is the Global Head and General Manager, IoT and Smart City at Wipro. So, shall I start with Mr. Ashish? I've got a question for you, Mr. Ashish, just to kickstart the dialogue, which is readiness to leverage IoT, sensors, smart meters, and smart cities to track assets and people. Where are we in this space?
Good afternoon to you all. Prashant, if we look at the smart city state, 100 smart city mission, which was launched by Government of India in last tenure, that is already into a stage where phase one of cities is implemented or under implementation. There is some echo. Yeah. And good part is that some of the basic requirements are already met as part of this phase one, in terms of integrated command control center, in terms of setting up augmenting network further, and putting up some of the use cases. Now, different cities have used different priority-based use cases. Metering, of course, from a power perspective in India is with utilities, but water is one of the segments which communities or situations are taking into account. While there are other aspects which plays a significant role in terms of enabling services in the city, and those initiatives are in mixed state, I would say. So while basic infrastructure is in place, many of these initiatives are taken in bits and pieces in cities, and there is a background or say the basic launchpad available, but actual deployment of these sensors at large in the city is yet to be taken up. But the phase two, which many cities are already working on, is definitely working in that direction. So we are in the right phase in terms of seeing these initiatives forward and make cities much smarter than what we have achieved in phase one.
Let us ask an extending question to Aditya, considering here the integrated platform has a key role in making cities smarter. How can platforms like yours, integrated tech platforms, will help define future of digital logistics, Aditya, considering you want to make our cities more smart and company like yours play a vital role in making logistics smart for us?
Sure. So basically, we are a location intelligence and data platform. And what we do is we look at all cycles of the logistics value chain from the planning stage, which is what we call the first mile, through the actual trip execution, through what we call now as last mile, which has become a very, very critical component, and then actually help with the post-trip analysis. So in the planning stage, we actually kind of look at dynamic route optimization as an example, and figure out what's the planning I need to do to get the best ETAs as I start my trip. We look at what is the initial cost that I need to be driving on those trips. So that's all on the planning piece. And then actually, as you actually move into the actual execution of the trip, then we can actually get into understanding the real-time traffic data or the traffic incidents on the road, and then be able to compute very accurate ETAs across multimodal shipments. Right? So we're able to then tell the driver kind of, what is the estimated ETA based on where they are on that condition. And then through that, then we can actually get into what's called last mile, which has become, like I said, it's become actually the most expensive part of the logistics value chain. And that's where we're looking for a lot more efficiency. So in the last mile, we basically kind of look at building an integrated stack, which will look at things like job planning, dynamic replanning, dispatch, as well as tracking of the asset. And then we actually get into the post-trip analysis. We actually go back and figure out, this is what I had set up in the planning stage of my trip. What have my cost parameters been in terms of diesel consumption, toll costs, and so on? What was the driver behavior and analysis? Did I reach the right SLAs for delivering my shipment? Did I meet the right ETAs? So we can provide a full post-trip analysis as well. So what we're providing is an integrated logistics stack that goes from first to mid to last mile, from a pre-trip to a post-trip analysis.
Thank you, Aditya. I think just extending this further, Mr. Srikant, considering you are one of the largest CPG companies in India, what's the nature of technology investment do you believe that supply chain companies or companies should make in supply chain, both last mile as well as solutions that are required to make your planning better, make your production cheaper, better, faster, etc.?
Hi, Prashant, and thanks for having me on this panel. It's a pleasure to interact with all of you. I think as any customer-driven organization, the most important metric that we would have to measure the performance of a supply chain would be fill rates. So for me, how do we go about ensuring that we maintain the highest level of customer service would be the most important factor. And we do a lot of pieces in supply chain and in demand towards ensuring that we build transparency in the process and in doing that transparency, ensure that we increase the supplier fill rate. So I think if you're asking for the single most important factor is to fulfill the orders of the customer. Now, the customers are at various levels. And for us as an FMCG organization, we believe when a customer that we have acquired reaches the shop to buy his product or looks on an online portal to get his product, he gets it when he reaches there. So the availability is there for that customer. And to ensure that customer gets his product, the whole chain needs to have the availability managed. So ensuring every leg or every node in the supply chain has order fulfillment levels to its highest is probably the only metric that I would probably have towards ensuring a good supply chain performance. Of course, the only balancing factor to it is the cost. So everything comes at a cost. So there is a value towards ensuring availability. What is the cost that we're willing to pay for that customer service is what is the, I would say, trade-off that we as customers would want to look at when we look at technology.
Thank you, Srikant. So just extending this to specifically customer focus, what is the customer behavior? And perhaps we can have a point of view from each of you, because each of you is customers. What is the customer behavior or customer's expectation in terms of response time, real-time updates for the inquiries and orders that you would have? Perhaps less for, say, Srikant, from a consumer products perspective, because you'll be selling through distributors and retail. But for the rest, can I ask this, how do you see this happening? Request Mr. Ashish, if you can start, because you can give a view from a consulting point of view, as you would be seeing clients asking for this, and then we, you and I, go about helping clients with this kind of details, ensuring that customers can get faster and better information about what they are expecting to buy or buy from these platforms. Ashish, and then we can move on to ask more details around this from Krishnu and Anirudh.
Yeah, sure, Prashant. So it's not about a single channel workout. So ultimately, it's about how do we bring in all the elements have involved in any end-to-end supply chain logistics chain. And some of the elements, of course, are in direct control, and some are not in direct control of the e-commerce company or any of these organizations for this service. That's where the blockchain AIML plays a significant role, with common data lakes being the Government of India coming up with innovations like IBM, data exchange, smart cities with the various applications. And at a city level, if we talk about the last mile delivery and predictability of the same, all this federated and correlated analytics further help in getting the predictability. Like ITMS solutions, which are getting implemented in smart initiatives, they are going to bring predictability. But combining that with location services, which platforms like HERE brings in, it makes overall fruitful information with the right analytics models for customers to make things better from day-to-day life perspective. We can have more 30-minute kind of a tagline, 30-minute or free kind of a tagline, becoming a reality as we move into this technology collaboration.
Krishnu, do you want to have a point of view on this? Specifically customers and customer behavior and their expectations and what we are able to solve with technology?
Yeah, see, if we track the evolution of logistics and the entire ecosystem in India, you will see a lot of revolution that has happened in this space has happened in last decade. And this has happened mostly around e-commerce companies, or retail rather, the sector that I represent, and largely online retail. You had traditional logistic mechanism, largely capable of doing typical B2B point deliveries to businesses. But I think what retail has done in last 10 years is had revolutionized this whole logistic mechanism around consumers, right? So you see not just point-to-point delivery of large goods like a refrigerator or television or furniture coming to your doorstep. You see a 30 minutes food delivery or a grocery delivery hyper-local delivery mechanism that has come up in the last 10 years. All of this has happened around retail and online retail ecosystem. And this is something that has created a gap between the online retail. It has fulfilled all the consumer expectations for the consumers who are kind of opting for an online destination, online platform. But for the shoppers or the consumers who still rely on offline as a channel, this technological advantage of, say, logistics has not reached there yet. And that's an area which is yet to evolve or yet to get integrated with this logistics evolution that has happened. And that's where a company like Arzu or Ulan are coming up and integrating the fragmentation in that space and enabling offline retailers to be able to commit a better SLA, better visibility on the delivery when they are getting the product, and hence when they are able to deliver it to their customer. So I think a lot is to happen in next 10 years that I see in offline retail and this whole B2B ecosystem, which unfortunately has not touched this space. But I think next 10 years belongs to this offline shoppers, offline retailers, and this whole area is yet to evolve. And we see that happening now. You're not audible, Prashant.
Sorry, I was on mute. Anirudh, do you want to throw more light on this, considering your your product range is both retail as well as bought at industrial scale as well?
Yeah, sure. Thanks, Prashant. So just taking the point ahead on customer behavior, I think this entire e-commerce revolution, which has happened over the last maybe 5 to 7 years, has really changed the customer expectation, even in probably product segments like tires. I mean, I really don't see today the talk in, let's say, I'm of course representing supply chain, and the talk between supply chain and sales and any consumer facing function today is no different than probably what would be happening in a FMCG or a, let's say any other company. Because I think there are three things which I feel any customer today possesses, of course, differing maybe in terms of the extent based on the geography, etc. One, the consumer has a very wide choice, and that's true for, let's say, a product like tire, or even maybe my erstwhile company where it was in paints, for example. The second factor is the consumer today is much more learned, and he knows quite a bit of even technicalities about the product. So the dealer, or let's say even a company representative, can't really influence the choice maybe the way it was being done earlier. And of course, there is a certain loyalty with respect to, let's say, a brand or a product, and people are looking at the right product at the right price point. So I see the consumer behavior in my kind of industry no different than, let's say, any other, and people are not really the tolerance levels with respect to and coming into let's say the supply chain domain, the tolerance with respect to availability of products, right products at the right time, as we say, is very, very low, and it's probably just going down as probably the time proceeds, and people are looking at availability as their right. So the other point I just wanted to share was with respect to how maybe technology is sort of influencing various parts of what we do in, let's say, in terms of the decision making in supply chain. Let's say, be it in the area of demand planning or in the area of, let's say, optimized production dispatch planning or inventory placement at the right location. So all the decisions which we take today have to necessarily be enabled by some or the other technology. I mean, given the kind of variables maybe one has to handle, it is just not possible to sort of deliver the required service levels, so to say, at the right cost without, let's say, technology. And I'll not probably go into details now, but I think all the aspects of supply chain, from demand planning to probably inventory placement and production dispatch planning, need to be handled in a unified platform so as to respond well to the changing demand. That's, I think, something which has become very essential. The other aspect I just want to touch upon now, I think given all this, the ability to detect problems and to mitigate the problems or the deviations from the plan is something which is becoming very, very important, I think. Because you can't really, and it could be a post-COVID effect or maybe changing demand patterns or whatever, but you could, you can never sort of, you know, make a month plan and just be rest assured that 30 days you don't have to really do anything other than that. I do think that's the way it works. So to really work on a day-to-day basis to sort of you know, change your plans and replan things. So that's something which is going to be possible only with technology adoption.
Thank you, Anirudh. So just a very specific question, because other than the fact that you are in the business of tires, which enable logistics, frankly, at all levels, what are you doing? What is your view on connected tires? How ready are we to leverage sensors, IoTs, and tires, and offer proactive service support to the likes of Arzu or the likes of Aditya's business, where they can offer more details to people on the road, saying where we are headed, and are we headed in the right direction? Are we having traffic jams, etc., etc.?
Yeah, I think it's something which is a very interesting intervention, I think, which is happening. Certain companies in India have already experimented with it also. So the idea is to put to use the IoT and the technology which is available to sort of, you know, how can it help the driver, how can it help the owner of the vehicle in terms of maybe, you know, in a context of, let's say, tire, how much is the wear and tear, how much is the remaining life, how much is the tire pressure, and what are the proactive actions which, let's say, the owner or the driver can take. That's one aspect of it, and it's sort of, you know, getting enabled by certain IoT sensors. That's one. The other aspect is also to track, let's say, the life of the tire, which sort of, you know, becomes quite essential in certain customer segments, such as fleet and certain maybe institutional customers. So where it's not just about selling the products, but also selling the services. So adoption of IoT technology in this, let's say, area, in terms of embedded sensors, is a evolving field, I think, and has a lot of potential, I would say.
Thank you, Anirudh. A question that comes to my mind, which perhaps applies both to yourself and Srikant, is how technology can help build responsive supply chain and manage disruptions in Srikant's world, which is very consumer specific, items which are small in value, consumed on a day-to-day basis, versus your case where someone will buy something, will last for a couple of years before the person will go and buy the next one. So how do you see technology can be build a responsive supply chain for you and build customer loyalty for you? Srikant, do you want to start and then give it back to Anirudh?
I'll make a attempt at it. I believe in most consumer-driven goods companies, broadly where you have goods moving, we have two pieces that we would want to, you know, have as data. First is sensing of demand, on how do we sense demand at different nodes. And the second piece is how do we serve that demand. So basically these two parts are where technology, and this basically takes care of the entire gamut of what supply chain actually does. And under serving of demand, you have two spaces again. What is the speed of service and what's the cost at which that speed is achieved? So, you know, at every element of a supply chain, whether it is supply planning, whether it's demand planning, whether it's distribution, warehouse management, logistics, last mile, in each of these elements, I think the question that we are answering is, do we know what is the consumer behavior and has the consumer behavior reached up to me? And that's the single platform of sensing of demand. And to what is it that I can do as technology to serve that demand? So let me take the example of just the last mile connect. So under serving the demand, obviously we've seen that a simple delivery process typically has the various stages. So if you've bought a product on Flipkart or Amazon, it tells you which warehouse that your product is currently. Maybe it's left from Gurgaon and then to Bombay and then to a near hub and then to you. As long as you have traceability of the whole product, you tend to feel everything is under control. So there are, apart from sensing and serving, I think the third element which is coming, which is very critical to supply chain right now, is the ability to trace. In fact, even for a Swiggy order, where the tolerance time could be as low as 15 minutes, as soon as you see that scooter, even if that scooter takes 30 minutes to reach you, you're still seeing that the scooter is coming to you. So the tolerance time is slightly higher as soon as the traceability is there. Even though food is hunger and you would want the food to come in as quickly as possible, there's really the lowest tolerance time that we have. So I think technology comes into play in sensing, serving, and in current space, some bit on traceability as well.
Thank you, Shrikant. I think you rightly pointed out, I actually ordered food 3-4 days back, and I ordered some food from an app, and the other food was directly ordered to a restaurant. And I was really, really unhappy with the restaurant, because while both the foods arrived simultaneously, the restaurant, I didn't see that scooter moving at all, anywhere. So I was really, really worried whether the food is going to arrive on time or not. But that's just my personal experience. Anurudh, considering your world, we've got similar sense, serve, and trace. Considering, say, car goes bust, the tire goes away, someone needs the tire urgently, and you are running something by which you can arrange that for a person to get a tire replaced. How can this help you create the right customer experience in your world?
Yeah, I'll just take from an important point which Rikan mentioned on traceability. If I just look at, let's say, traceability or the visibility in supply chain logistics, I think there are 5 or 6 questions which maybe we are trying to always answer or we are trying to understand. And I'll take it from, let's say, the manufacturing end to, let's say, the customer. So when it comes to manufacturing, we are looking at, let's say, in a part which is going to be produced, what raw materials are used, in which probably shift or by which crew the part was produced. And then when it comes to, let's say, the dispatch process, we are looking at in which loading shift or bay, which vehicle was used, which transport was used. And then when was it moved to a which DC or a CNF it was moved. So the entire link of traceability from manufacturing, and this I'm looking from the point of that part or the object which is sort of getting produced and getting sold. And for each part, and in this case, maybe the tire, if I imagine, has a certain history, right? From the time it is getting molded, manufactured, till it goes to, let's say, a warehouse and it is getting built from there. And coming to, let's say, the end point, let's say, from where it gets built, to which customer it is getting built, what is the kind of product performance post billing, and any complaint history, any complaint with respect to the product. This entire gamut of things needs to be viewed into, let's say, a one information source. And of course, at each stage, the solutions are different, right from maybe MES to barcode to, let's say, track and trace through various technologies such as SIM-based or GPS devices, etc., and then WMS and all that. I think all these systems are going are required to sort of, you know, trace the part at each step of the supply chain or the logistics process as it is. Coming to the specific question on, let's say, how customer demand coming at a point of sale is getting translated, I think I'm sure the audience also would know the solution lies in two domains. One is, of course, in the domain of the company, and in the other in the domain of, let's say, the vendor partner who is there. How well we are going to integrate the system? I think this integration of, let's say, the systems and the stocks and inventory positions are, I think, at different maturity level in different companies and industries. But that's where I think the information capturing needs to happen to know which customer is coming and, let's say, getting served from, let's say, whether it's an exclusive shop or a common brand shop, etc., and host of data which probably resides. Today, the connectivity, I think, is largely limited up to the company warehouse, and a lot of data gets calculated, captured even at that stage, and you can sort of, you know, get back to the customer or customer as in you are, let's say, a distributor or a dealer for any lost order. So that much of integration through, of course, a combination of your core ERP and other technology solutions has been done. So it sort of, you know, helps you to track the demand which you probably have not served in a particular geography.
Thank you. Just got a message that we've got 15 more minutes. So let's use 10 more minutes of discussion and then take a few questions. Okay. Aditya, so I think what Srikant and Anirudh said about sense, serve and trace. And I would put it as logistics planning and logistics execution. How can your platform at here help in execution part, perhaps sales part as well?
Yeah, no, absolutely. So, you know, see, we talked about pre-trip planning, but the execution is actually the biggest piece. And that's the actual trip execution. But the biggest piece that we see following that is actually the last mile. So the biggest cost for logistics today is the last mile. It's about 50% of the total logistics cost. But what's more important that I think customers are realizing is it is also a way of generating net new revenue, building new types of revenue streams through this whole last mile. It's also the fastest way that you can actually lose customers. So we've seen research where, you know, 55% of customers will switch to another supplier if there is something wrong with that last mile delivery. So what we have done to manage this whole last mile is we've actually kind of built an end-to-end SaaS solution, which will actually solve problems around job planning, dynamic replanning, looking at dispatch and tracking to the final last mile. And what's unique is the metrics which we brought up earlier. The KPIs are not just cost KPIs. So we look at things like the stocks per tour and how we can kind of help increase that. We look at ETA accuracies and how do we build better accuracies. So we've seen through last mile that there we can build accuracies up to about 25%. We look at obviously things like vehicle utilization and the overall operating cost for your fleet, including things like fuel costs and trip costs. But there's another component as well, and that's around SLAs. Are you meeting the customer's SLA requirements? And where we've kind of rolled out our last mile logistics platform, we've seen about 30% increase in terms of overall SLA management. So the biggest opportunity continues to be on the execution piece, and within execution, last mile is going to be the key driver moving forward, and having the right type of platform solutions to trace down to that level is going to be very, very important moving forward, especially in this whole pandemic environment where everybody's ordering online. I think it's now just become a norm for customers to expect on-time deliveries, same-day deliveries. And as we talked about, switching costs become lower because they'll immediately switch to a competitor if you don't meet their requirements. And so the solution that we've built around that will kind of help drive that level of traceability.
Thank you. Thanks, Aditya. Since we are going to be short on time, one question that I'm going to ask, which touches all our lives, and perhaps I'll need answers from each of us. It's about environment sustenance, sustainability and governance, or sustainability, and how can we get more green? How can technology in logistics help us be more green? Essentially, considering logistics or this home delivery, etc., has brought a lot of waste added in terms of packing, use of plastic, and then again, loads of people on road. I was talking to, I think, Swiggy yesterday, and they mentioned that 40,000 miles is what they cover every day on that Swiggy scooter, which shows up on their app. So let's start from Kushnu and then cover all of us, and perhaps we can end at Ashish. Kushnu.
I will just, since we have been discussing a lot on the tracking, traceability, etc., so I'll just throw some light on how what's happening in retail space in general, and then maybe I'll come to this. The offline retail ecosystem, though you hear about a lot about omni-channel retail, etc., the challenge of the challenge that these retailers, because we this is a large contributor to our GDP, large economy in itself, that they have had so far is that they are limited by their ability to stock, which means they need that much space and that much capital, and only that they can trade and do retails, and that's how they've been running their businesses. It was all fine till the time there was no online platform as such. But the moment you have online, which is kind of offering you 10 times more product selection on a single destination, and then it's offering you a next day and 48 hours delivery and superior access to pricing, the challenge for retail ecosystem comes. And this was the big channel. This is still the biggest challenge that these guys are facing. And that's where one of the solutions that companies like us offering is of digital inventory, which is able to kind of give them access to a 10x larger selection without stocking those inventories in store, and all these comes with a better data management of what retail that's happening from each of these stores, what sort of customer that's coming in that cluster. And then based on that, you are able to customize the inventory requirement for that specific cluster, and you have your centralized inventory somewhere that this retailer has access to, you know, and real time he is able to grow his business 10 times because of larger access to digital inventory. And then that's integrated with the last mile delivery with direct visibility to his consumer. Just imagine an offline store is able to give visibility to its customer that where it's, you know, order is that he's placed today or yesterday, right? So this is something that's happening in this space, and this is changing the offline retail landscape majorly. And that's where I see the next decade belongs. A lot of this happening in offline retail ecosystem. On the sustainability front, environment, etc., I think that is happening in this space on the green truck technology. There is a lot happening on the green bike delivery mechanism that's happening, and we have a lot of expert from logistics space. I think they will be able to better throw better light on this, so it's just left to them.
So let's move to hearing from Anirudh around that. How do we make ESG a reality, or sustainable way of living a reality with better logistics planning using technology?
If I just look at sustainability in terms of emissions and lesser rubber burnt on the road, I think primary logistics is one of the major contributors to that. And while I think some of the initiatives are in nascent stage, I think one promising option which I feel is the multimodal transportation. And that is something which is evolving. And I think the challenge there is to assess the trade-offs between, let's say, the transit times versus the emission and the cost per kg per kilometer reduction, also in terms of inventory allocation. So if I look at the overall logistics landscape, mainly in terms of the outbound logistics and to an extent also into inbound, I think multimodal is a promising option. Again, since there are multiple handoffs which are involved, the need is sort of, you know, sort of unified way to track and trace the shipments which are there, so that you don't really end up, you know, filling up with multiple agencies. And just to share, I think today some of the multimodal which are there, which sort of, you know, being done, are mainly coastal and road combinations. Although there is also rail and road, which is you know, becoming feasible in certain sectors. But that's something which is looking a promising intervention.
Thanks, Anurag. I think we're just short of time now, so I'll like to have a point of view from Ashish on better ESG from a perspective of a consulting organization. How do you see we can help as consultants to our clients like SEAT or Godrej, or for that matter, Arzu as well, in better achieving with technology sustainable way of living? Ashish.
Sorry. So two, three key points. First is physical internet, which is becoming a reality soon, and that will help getting the logistics and supply chain completely IoT and digital enabled. And faster, all the organizations which are connected to that adopt that methodology. Earlier, we will reach the sustainability goals to an extent. Second, I was talking to Uber the other day, and Uber Foods target, when they were talking about, they said that their target is to have less than 50% deviation from the intended route while they return after dropping customers to deliver the food, which means we are cutting down that much of time on road against, say, the any other food delivery organization. And third is, how do we get a last mile improved further in terms of having a collaboration between the controlled systems and uncontrolled systems. And when I say uncontrolled systems, again, things which are controlled by larger authorities in terms of adaptive traffic, in terms of the wait time at signals. So that not only gives predictability, but also gives lesser oil burn and lesser tire time, or say rubber time on road. And one of the city which we worked with, they could cut down the drive time in peak hours from point A to B by 30%. Using the location services, map data, and just-in-time image analytics data on that. So technology collaboration is the key. So we can't say that we will work on only what we need to deploy. We have to use whatever options available, get into those data analytics, and bring them together to improve on our options. That's what is going to be the key.
Thanks, Ashish. I think it has been great talking to all of you. A great discussion, at least enlightening for me. I learned a lot of things. I was not really much aware of what the model of business for Arzu is, but I learned about that as well. I think for the rest, I learned a lot about here yesterday itself. Back to our host. And if there are any questions, we can, as a myself as a moderator and panelists, can take a shot at answering them. We can do another 5 minutes, I believe.
Right, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, everyone, for an engaging discussion. And a special thanks to all of you for being here with us today and making this possible. And another thanks goes out to all our attendees as well who are here with us today. Thank you so much, everyone. And we'll be back with the next session in a few minutes. Thanks so much, and please stay tuned.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys. Thank you, IMA team. Thanks, Prashant. Nice
Thank you.
Thank you.